Although Stonehenge is famous as a celestial temple, archaeologists suspect a monument this big must have attracted other uses. But what? Modern forensic techniques are revealing the surprising answer. Because some of the people who came here never left.
We know there are 300 to 400 burials in the general region.
Archaeological bone expert Jackie McKinley suspects many of these people came to Stonehenge for more than just 2 days a year. They came to live and work, and she believes their bones can prove her theory.
A lot of the time, the dead are buried in certain positions, postures, with certain materials with them. So there's a whole variety of things that I go to look for, because that can tell me something about their life, but also about Stonehenge itself.
Buried beneath the stones lay human remains. Four skeletons, one decapitated. Another with fatal arrow wounds and the arrowheads that killed him. They're clues to the ancient people that came here 4,500 years ago. But these skeletons are not alone. Within a ring of 56 pits that surround the stones lie the cremated remains of dozens of people, and many more are buried outside this ring. What can these remains tell us about how Stonehenge was really used? Today, Jackie's examining one of the most complete skeletons found in the area.
From the skeleton, I can see that this was a young adult male, probably in his mid-20s.
Dying young wasn't unusual in prehistoric Britain, but the objects buried with this man were anything but ordinary. Jackie believes they're a clue to his occupation.
This is a pair of gold ornaments that were found rolled together inside the mouth. You see they're tucked against the right-hand side of the inner jaw, which means they were either placed in the mouth at the time of death or certainly before burial. And these really are very rare. There are only about 8 pairs known from the country.
Ancient people often buried their dead with possessions that hint at their owner's profession. Did this man trade in fine jewelry?
We're at the very early stages of metalworking. These are very finely worked items. And to be able to have not just the technology, but the skill to have learned how to change something which was essentially a lump of rock into something that delicate and that beautifully worked would really have been seen as something quite magical.
Jackie thinks this magic may have been worked by the man buried next to him.
There were 2 graves that were within 3 meters of each other.
The second, older man was buried with the same rare gold ornaments, together with simple metalworking tools.
I think he was the person who worked the magic. I think he was the person who could make those changes from pieces of rock to items of beauty and items of utility.
Jackie is convinced both men were metalworkers who came to Stonehenge to make and sell their precious metal goods. To her, Stonehenge was more than a monument. It was a thriving hub for craft and trade. But Jackie's discovered something even more extraordinary. These ancient craftsmen had come a long way to set up shop at Stonehenge.
There are certain chemical signatures which are taken up from the groundwater, which can get fixed in the dental enamel as it's developing in the growing child. By looking at those signatures and relating them to the geology, different geologies across Europe, we can more or less work out the regions that people came from.
Prehistoric Britons hadn't yet discovered the wheel, so investigators assumed they lived and died in one place. But the evidence from the older man shatters this belief.
The signal that we got from him suggests he may have been from Central Europe, from the area of what we now know as Germany.
That's a 700-mile hike from Stonehenge. The younger man's results are equally astonishing. He was born at Stonehenge, but spent his teens in Central Europe.
The fact that we've been able to demonstrate that people might have moved several times in their lifetime between, you know, quite long distances is absolutely fascinating. What you've got is a connection between people over a large geographic area. And whether they kept that connection because of trade or because of family, or probably a combination of the two, that is just, it's so modern in many ways. It really is very similar to what we would be doing now.
This discovery rewrites our understanding of the ancient world. 4,000 years ago, these two men traveled vast distances over land and sea. They were part of a complex web of connections, perhaps with the marketplace of Stonehenge at its core. And they weren't the only foreign travelers to make their way to this corner of southwest England. Evidence from hundreds of graves shows Stonehenge was a multinational melting pot. The graves are filled with items from distant lands. A green jade axe head from Italy. An amber necklace from Denmark. And blue beads from Greece. One dagger combines whale bone from as far away as Scandinavia with bronze made from Cornish tin and Welsh copper.